My name is Peter Cole, and some of you might know, at least one of you, Tony here, knows that I wrote a book called Wobblies on the Waterfront. If you've read my book, thank you very much. I work on The Industrial Workers of the World. I've worked on several different things, but this, I started researching this subject some decades ago. Local 8 isn't the eighth local in the entire union, but it was the eighth local that was issued a charter, right? Among marine transport workers, and so they become called Local 8. There's lots of locals out there. IWW Local 8, I think, is one of the most fascinating stories in American history. I've devoted a lot of time to thinking about them. And for many of us also, the leader of its union, Ben Fletcher, pictured on the bottom left, is the most well-known individual in it. Why is Local 8 so interesting? Among many other reasons, unlike most other IWW locals, they actually didn't just sort of have power for a brief moment, but relatively speaking, were the most long-lasting and durable local of any of its locals in the early 20th century. And for a second reason connected to the first, because it was the local where they put into practice the idea of being inclusive to all workers, regardless of race or ethnicity or nationality, right? And so the IWW was originally multiracial and multi-ethnic, eventually became actually majority African-American, although always very quite diverse. African-Americans were part of Local 8 from its inception. So too were many hundreds of Irish-Americans and many hundreds of Irish immigrants. A lot of peoples from Eastern Europe, Poles and Lithuanians, probably Roman Catholics, scattered other groups, including blacks from the West Indies. So an incredibly diverse workforce. We might be aware that the United States is an incredibly diverse place. And so if you want to organize a workplace, well, you should be ready to organize a diverse workplace, right? Unfortunately, most unions have failed to do that. And that might be one of the reasons why most unions have failed. And so Local 8 is sort of exceptional in its time. To understand Local 8, we have to understand the ideology of the union it was a part of. The Industrial Workers of the World was, as we talked about earlier and as the film also showed, was a radical union, committed to radical change, most particularly overthrowing the economic system of capitalism and instilling a new economic system in which ordinary workers would benefit from the work that they undertook. In Philadelphia, then the third largest city in the United States and maybe the fifth largest port in the United States, shipping, it was important. Shipping was why William Penn put the colony of Philadelphia where Philadelphia is located. The map on the left shows you that it's essentially between two rivers, one of which is a large river, the one to the east, Delaware River, the one to the west, Schuylkill River, although modern-day Philadelphia actually is also to the west of Philadelphia. If you've ever heard of West Philly, right, that's actually west of the Schuylkill River. The Schuylkill River is the smaller river to the farther to the left, right? The image on the right, that's the Delaware River, gives you a sense of the many rivers, ships in what was called the stream, right, i.e. the river, right? Why does Philadelphia have such a big port? It's because Philadelphia was a massive industrial city that produced all sorts of goods, shipped out raw materials like agricultural products from the hinterland, coal, especially from the mines in eastern Pennsylvania, but also hundreds of thousands of workers in textiles. They had lots of workers who were making metal machine parts, also did things like build ships, both commercial ships as well as warships, etc. So Philadelphia was a big industrial city, one of the biggest in the country. It did have, even before World War I, separate from the IWW, a very low rate of unionism, less so than other industrial cities of the time. Seen as being more conservative in many ways, but also much more pro-employer, and so very hard to organize in Philadelphia. We're also mindful that in the early 20th century, America was among the worst times to be a person of color in the United States. There's many examples of how racism and white supremacy are the norm in early 20th century America. I give you one example here. The most popular film of this era was The Birth of a Nation, a film that you can also watch on YouTube and which I encourage you to do, basically celebrating the Ku Klux Klan for saving white Americans from the threat that black people posed to the nation if they gained equal rights and power with white Americans. And of course, as the film highlights, in case you haven't seen it, that all black men ultimately really just want is white women. And so to protect white womanhood as well as white America, we need the Ku Klux Klan, right? Woodrow Wilson, the president of the time, screens the film, calls it his favorite film of all time, right? This film literally rebirths the Ku Klux Klan, which was defunct, right? But is recreated because the film inspired some white Americans that we needed the Klan back, right? That's the era that African Americans live in. Philadelphia, for those of us who don't know Philadelphia so well, Philadelphia was the largest black population outside of the South, bigger than New York City actually at the turn of the 20th century, although by the 1920s, New York City had become a larger black community than Philadelphia. W.E.B. Du Bois, the sort of legendary intellectual and activist, the first black man to get a PhD from Harvard, he actually lived and researched in Philadelphia in the 1890s in his first book, which some people consider the first scholarly work of sociology ever, was called The Philadelphia Negro, in which basically his central thesis is that racism is central to the lived experience of black Philadelphians and essentially who restricted their work options in a myriad ways, men and women. In more recent times, the man on the right might be familiar, Mumia Abu-Jamal, accused of and still on death row for supposedly killing a white police officer in Philadelphia in 1981. Many people feel his trial and subsequent treatment has been makes him a political prisoner. The image on the middle, in 1985, sort of a radical fringe black organization called MOVE was literally bombed by the Philadelphia police when they bombed a street in West Philadelphia, causing a number of deaths and many wounded as the city, well, there hasn't been actually a government bombing in the United States by air. It's sort of shocking who gets bombed. You know, radical black nationalists get bombed, right? So that's the context, a little bit more about the work, right? Doc work has very different nowadays than it was in the past, but for many, many centuries, even millennia, doc work was not so different. It involves brutal manual labor in which men, overwhelmingly, almost entirely exclusively men, load and unload ships using their skills in order to correctly stow cargo aboard ships, because every commodity is different and every ship is different, and so actually if you don't well balance a ship, ships sink. Right, and so although this is considered unskilled work, actually the work of traditional longshoring quite skilled, but it does definitely also involve incredible manual labor to move hundreds and thousands of pounds for hours and hours on end and day and night. It is also a process that traditionally, because the work was not considered skilled, and because America has a lot of people, and because a lot of rural Americans were moving to cities, and because a lot of rural Europeans were moving to American cities, there was often a labor surplus. And as we know, labor surpluses can benefit employers. So the hiring system, which was nicknamed the shape-up, was considered oppressive. It encourages basically potential employees to bribe the boss in order to get a job, who might hire based on being of the same race, the same religion, the same neighborhood, often excluding people of color and immigrants. Once you're hired, dock workers work in teams, can't load a ship by yourself. And so as 100 to 150 men might work a single ship. And often workers had partners where they would load and unload things together. And so as a result of this process, right, and as a result of more generally the nature of the work, dock workers, past and present, are unusually likely to organize into unions and are unusually likely to be willing to go on strike. Literally, the word strike, in case you were unaware, means to take down a sail of a ship, right? And so sailors created the word strike. And so the marine transport industry, shipping, is where the term strike originates. So dock workers and sailors appreciate their power. Why? Because the ship must sail on time, which more generally we think of as the concept of time is money, right? That time is money, right? That's a capitalist concept, right? And so the Wobblies and dock workers sort of appreciate that they have power. They have the power at the point of production to stop work, right? What's the problem with that? Of course, workers are divided. Workers are divided. We're divided in many ways, right? You like the Browns, I like the Lions. I don't know, is that a division? A third African Americans, a third Irish Americans, a third European immigrants. This workforce didn't just happen to become that diverse in those particular ways. Employers essentially consciously hire in order to divide. That is why you need a radical union in order to organize this workplace, because otherwise the workers will be subject to the prejudices that they have come to embrace, right? And so what we've got here is an image of Ben Fletcher in the aftermath of the trial, one of them that Ahmed talked about, right? Like in 1918, Ben Fletcher and others will go to prison, although this is one of the best pictures we've got of Ben Fletcher, period. Fletcher, we don't know that much about. I don't know much about, and therefore really nobody alive anymore knows much about him, unfortunately. But Fletcher was born and raised in Philadelphia. His parents were from Maryland and Virginia. He was 20 years old in 1910, and already was a socialist before he was a Wobbly, right? I don't know anything more than that, but I could guess that he was walking down the street in his neighborhood and was listening to a soapboxer, a street organizer, and decided to stick around and listen a bit more, and maybe sort of borrowed or bought some literature and started to read and started to talk to a few more people and found that he came to sort of embrace these ideas, and then very quickly also joined the IWW and became a street speaker in Philadelphia and neighboring communities before the dock workers' initial strike, before Local 8. Fletcher's already a Wobbly, Fletcher's already a local activist. Yeah. Fletcher's supposedly a great speaker, although we have no recordings of him, to my knowledge, right? In the spring of 1913, spring's often a great time to strike because more ships are moving. That means workers have more power to essentially exert pressure on employers who want to concede to demands in order to keep the ships working, right? Why is May Day on May Day? It's actually, it's just because it's springtime, right? That would be a common, yeah. Workers go on strike, just like in the film where it talks about in Lawrence or in Patterson. There were Wobblies around, but they didn't pull this strike. It was dock workers who were organized self, right, who go on strike, and then essentially some members, including Ben Fletcher, who worked on the docks, basically take over the leadership of the strike, and the workers essentially vote to join the Local 8 of the IWW in the midst of the strike, right? And so the IWW essentially provides the key leadership and the ideology and the tactics that essentially make the strike effective. Yeah. And after 2 weeks, the employers concede their demands. Interesting things that we could think about that, among others, that at this time, shipping was somewhat less global than it became in terms of its ownership. And so Local 8 was able to play employers off of each other, which is flipping the traditional divide and conquer strategy against the bosses, right? And so when they basically got one boss to concede, other bosses quickly had to essentially concede. Otherwise, boss one was going to sort of get the jump on sort of shipping. After Local 8 sort of becomes the representatives of dock workers, approximately 4,000 in Philadelphia, maybe, Local 8 immediately starts instituting changes that are quite dramatic. Off the bat, right, a union that is white majority has a black leader, right? That alone sort of puts it sort of atypical. They integrate gangs. Ethnic and racial divisions were used by employers not just in hiring but also on the job, so that a Polish gang would compete against an Irish gang, would compete against a black gang. IWW Local 8 mandates integrated gangs, Leadership is integrated. Yeah, social events, limited evidence, but nevertheless, all the evidence suggests integrated, right? They had their own hall. Blacks and whites would socialize in the hall. If you're not working that day, there's no TV, there's no radio, there's no internet. What do you do that day? You go to the hall anyway and hang out. Who you're hanging out with, your fellow workers, who happen to be of a variety of different ethnic and racial groups, picnics, parties, smokers, as they call them, right? Dances, fundraisers, all sort of very mixed. And with Ben Fletcher as one of, but not the only, leader. Quick example of how Local 8 organized, not unique to Local 8, of course, what we call direct action. Local 8, like the fellow worker said earlier, Matt, I think Wallies don't sign contracts. Why? That way you can strike when you want. So basically, the Local 8 had oral agreements where it applied to the entire waterfront. All workers got paid X, you know, for instance. But that wasn't written down anywhere, right? Like, and so if employers try to break agreements or if workers are upset, they might stop work on the job, mid-job, right? And so the classic example I use in my book, employer tries to go around the union instead of hiring all Wobblies, hires only some Wobblies. Wobblies wait for the shift to start, loading the ship, right? Halfway through the shift, Wobblies say, hey, you've got to lay off these workers who aren't in the union. Employer says, fuck you. And then the Wobblies walk off the ship, right? Of course, there's no one waiting to be hired because it's mid-shift, right? And so Wobblies would exert pressure in these quickie strikes. These are lost to history. They're undocumented, right? Like, there's no way to document these. They're lost. But this is not unique to dock work either. But nevertheless, this sort of example would be how it's done. You know, I brought, but I think I forgot back at my where I'm staying with Laverne and Bob. These are examples of buttons, right? So the union would issue buttons to demonstrate that you were a paid-up member of the union, and so everyone would know who was essentially a member and who wasn't, and who was sort of keeping up with their dues or not. One of the things that Local 8 tried to do in order to sort of develop solidarity and sort of traditions is they would celebrate their birthday, right? And so every year they would stop work on their birthday. The first time they tried this, 1914, employer said, if you don't show up for work, don't show up for work tomorrow, right? Like halfway through the day after basically everyone didn't show up for work, the bosses are saying, well, will you work the evening shift? And so basically dock workers would celebrate their birthdays. This tradition exists in many unions, but in the ILWU, the West Coast Dock Workers Union, for instance, they celebrate Bloody Thursday, which was the killing of two people in San Francisco in 1934 during their initial strike. And so their official, in their coastwide contract, right, they celebrate that event by a day off. It's a paid holiday for the union, right? And so you don't just have to take, I don't know, Veterans Day, right? Like, you can take, you can negotiate your own union holidays if you want, right? You know, although I'm highlighting Philadelphia, I've talked a lot about, in comments before, right, about global nature. The IWW appreciates that you can't organize one port and win, right, like, because employers can just move cargo to other ports, right, and so they're mindful of the fact that you don't want to be an island because then you can sort of be sort of avoided, right, so the Wobblies were trying to organize other ports, Baltimore, New York, Providence, Boston, Charleston, Newport News, with less success than they did in Philadelphia, but nevertheless, they constantly were trying to expand their numbers. They also tried to organize in related industries along the waterfront, so they unrefined sugar would come up from Cuba, and it used to be that sugar was refined in bigger cities in America, right, and then distributed to regional parts of the country, right, and so what do? Well, there are sugar refineries on the waterfront. Local 8 starts organizing the sugar refineries, right, they start organizing the sailors who are coming in on, off the ships, right, like, and so they would work in to expand into related industries. Ahmed talked about it better than I did, but during World War I, the government started to use the war as a means to attack the Union. The only thing I would say is that of the 101 Wobblies in Chicago's trial, six were Philadelphians, right, including Ben Fletcher, four other Philadelphians who were part of Local 8, and then a Spanish anarchist sailor who was a Wobbly, but who had made Philadelphia his home for a number of years, Manuel Ray, who actually, after he got out of Leavenworth, snuck back into the country and lived in the United States for the rest of his life until the 1980s under a different name, right? But I wish I had known that much longer ago, but I only discovered that a few years ago. Getting ahead, sort of to the end of this story, now Ahmed and the film talk about some of the factors that explain the decline of Local H and the IWW. One was repression from the state. There also were rivalries with the AFL. There also was rivalries with the Communist Party, which is newly emergent and challenging the IWW essentially for domination on the left. There's also sort of local as well as employer opposition. So in 1922, Local 8's members were locked out in November 1922. That's clever, right, for the bosses, because shipping starts to decline in the winter, and they have less work, but employers can survive maybe less work better than employees, right? It's getting cold, shipping is declining, they have less work, and also ethnic and racial tensions are used to divide this union further, and Local 8 is split. There's no union for a year or two, but into the vacuum comes the AFL's dock workers union called the International Longshoremen Association, the ILA, which came to represent Philadelphia dock workers. Philadelphia was the last major port in America to be represented by this union as opposed to the IWW. Local 8 disappeared, but a lot of the people who went into the ILA were, of course, former Wobblies, including the black man who's in the film featured earlier. Blacks generally do better in Philadelphia than in other cities. There's actually more blacks in the local leadership, but gangs are resegregated. The shape-up actually is brought back for in the 30s and 40s. It seems like in many ways the sort of the quality of work declined, and as a result of the decline of the IWW. Just very, very quickly, two things we might think about with the legacies of the IWW in Philadelphia. I mentioned one already, is that blacks in on the docks in Philadelphia actually are better off than blacks in New York or Boston or other ports in the Northeast. Second example is A. Philip Randolph, probably the most famous black labor leader in the history of the United States. Randolph was a huge fan of Ben Fletcher and Local 8. He was the co-editor of a socialist monthly called The Messenger in the late 19-teens and early 1920s, and he published multiple articles about Ben Fletcher and Local 8, including trying to secure his release from federal prison. He, of course, will later go on to form a union called the Brotherhood of Sweeping Car Porters. He will move somewhat rightward. He's no longer a socialist. I would call him a left liberal. But Randolph remains very important throughout the 1930s, 40s, 50s, and 60s. Randolph, of course, will be a sort of an elder statesman of civil rights by the 1960s. But the March on Washington in 1963 was essentially a sort of a second round version of a March on Washington that Randolph had threatened to pull in 1941, right? And so Randolph was sort of like an uncle to Martin Luther King, you might say, in terms of providing guidance to the civil rights movement in the 1960s. And finally, the union that I now study, among others, the ILWU, the West Coast Dock Workers, which adopted the motto of the IWW, an injury to one is an injury to all, but also is, I would suggest, today the most racially progressive union in the United States. They could be better, but America could be much better, obviously. But Local 10, in the San Francisco Bay Area is black majority. It has lots of Asian Americans, lots of Mexican Americans, as well as some white Americans. Martin Luther King will become an honorary member in 1967 of Local 10 when he becomes especially interested in unionism. And Paul Robeson before him had become a sort of an honorary member of the ILWU, right? And so the Wobblies' ideas live on, actually, in these West Coast dock workers in some very specific ways, including in Local 10, that elected leaders can't serve more than 2 years before they have to go back into the rank and file, which was a Wobbly thing. And so interesting examples of the legacies of the IWW. Thank you.